Good evening, everyone, from the locker room. This is Jim Miller along with Sid Michaels saying welcome to the 11th and final week of regular season play in local high school football. We begin tonight with the AA championship showdown in the Wyoming Valley Conference at Nanticoke between the Trojans and the Hawks of Hanover area. The defending state champions roll to a 39-14 win. Now some of the highlights from tonight's action. Double-A championship game, first drive of the evening. Hanover goes up top as quarterback Eric Pearson finds Russ Davis for 37 yards to the Nanticoke 16-yard line. Pearson caps off the drive by scoring from 5 yards out on the scramble in the corner. Hanover led it 7-0. Later in the game, Jamie Proctor gets the call, a tremendous run as he breaks several tackles along the way and rolls 24 yards for a key first down. Proctor caps off the drive by scoring from 6 yards out. Hanover led the Trojans of Nanticoke 14-0. The Hanover defense then puts points on the board as Allen Nice picks off the pass and turns it the other way. He would roll 30 yards for the score, and Hanover led the Trojans of Nanticoke 20-0. Later in leading 20-7, third quarter on 3rd and 17, Pearson finds Jim Pepperling for 21 yards to the Trojan 2-yard line. That set up the next score. It was now a 26-7 game. Kevin Proctor and Jim Pepperling scored the last two touchdowns. Proctor on this 2-yard run. Hanover wins the AA Conference Championship, downing Nanticoke in local high school football. In other games tonight, Berwick over Scranton Prep 27-0. Valley West defeats Coffin 38-6. Tom Honnell covered that twin bill and files this report.
It was nippy at the multi-purpose stadium, to say the least. However, Prep's Joe Grokowski heats things up with this reverse for 27 yards to the Berwick 27. However, after 15 plays and 7 minutes off the clock, Prep turns the ball over. And with that, it's time for a trip on Air Powellis. Ron Powellis, that is. 61 yards to Mike Elms, and the Dogs go out in front 7-0. In the second quarter, Ryan Mason caps off a 9-play drive with a 6-yard plunge. Berwick gears up for the playoffs with the drubbing of the Cavaliers. In Kingston, it's 19-6 Valley West in the third, and the Spartans are looking for more. Keith Adamski's interception gives the ball to Valley West at the Coughlin 41. On second down, George Young runs the halfback option to perfection to Adamski to the 11-yard line. 2 plays later, Young comes right at you, setting up first and goal on the 1-yard line. Jason McAvoy's plunge makes it 25-6, and the route was on. Ted Wozniak gets in on the act with this 1-yard carry, 31-6 Spartans. Finally, the defense puts the mark on victory when Adamski picks off his second of the half in the end zone. Valley West ends the season 8-3 and 5-1 in the conference. For the Scoreboard Show, Tom Honnell, Eyewitness Sports.
And another conference action tonight. Myers knocks off GAR 35-6. Pottsville defeats the Mountaineers of Hazleton 26-7. Tunkhannock over Abington Heights 28-6.
The number one attraction in the north in the Suburban Conference, the title showdown between Mid-Valley and Montrose. Congratulations to Jim Baghetta and his Spartans. They win it 34-16. Now some of the highlights from that ball game.
After a scoreless first period, Mid-Valley struck quickly on the first play of the second quarter. Jason Cuzzo goes off right tackle, makes several nice cuts, and goes 46 yards for the touchdown, and the Spartans were off and running 7-0. Montrose's next 4 offensive plays would result in 3 fumbles. Each was recovered by Mid-Valley, and the Spartans would turn each into scores. And each one of those was turned in by Cuzzo, who also accounted for 206 yards rushing. First a 4-yarder, it was 14-0. Then, with just under 3 minutes to play in the second period, another 4-yarder by the talented tailback made it 21-0. Then, from the 14-yard line, Cuzzo takes the screen, again makes a pretty cut near the sideline. He goes in for the 14-yard touchdown. Mid-Valley rolls over Montrose 34-16.
This team told me at the beginning of the year, they said, we're going after it and we're going all the way. And my God, they made me a believer. That I believe them. I believe in them every minute of every day that I'm with them.
Well, we knew that they were going to be a tough team to play, and we just came to play today, and that was the difference, you know. They're a tough team. I got to give them a lot of credit, but the boys just came to play today.
The win was the 10th against 1 loss for Mid-Valley. Both the Spartans and Montrose now advance to next week's Eastern Conference playoffs.
One other suburban game tonight. Old Forge defeated Wallenpaupack area 35-14. Now let's go south with a triple header. Mount Carmel down Shikellamy by 10, Tamaqua 39, Marion 20, North Schuylkill over Minersville 21-12. Kelly Reed covered that triple header, and here's her report.
The cold weather, a big factor in Mount Carmel on the opening kickoff as the Red Tornadoes mishandle the ball, finally recovering deep in their own territory. Then control problems again on the first play from scrimmage as Mount Carmel coughs up the ball and Ryan Bucher picks it up and hustles into the end zone for the touchdown. The two-point conversion was good. After a failed onside kick, the Red Tornadoes recovered with good field position. Two costly penalties called on Shikellamy set the stage for Jeremy Vlossi's touchdown for Mount Carmel. Final, Mount Carmel 24, Shikellamy 14. Late in the third quarter, a potboiler on a frigid night at Tamaqua as the Blue Raiders were locked in a 6-6 tie with powerful Marion Catholic. And then Mark Anushko, who continues to amaze, makes this exciting dash to the end zone. Touchdown, Tamaqua. Final, Tamaqua 39, Marion 20. In game number three, Minersville not only battled a frozen field, but a frozen scoreboard as well, as a hot North Schuylkill team proved too much for visiting Minersville. The final there, North Schuylkill 21, Minersville 12. Kelly Reed, Eyewitness Sports.
In the Williamsport area tonight, Montoursville, third consecutive unbeaten season. They beat Loyal Sock 32-6. Williamsport over Harrisburg 25-13. Scott Masteller covered those game and has some of the highlights.
Montoursville with the football, first quarter action. Brian Kennedy drops back. He's at his own 47. He'll find Rick Hagemeyer on the screen right side. Hagemeyer cuts left side. He's got lots of room. He'll go 53 yards for an early touchdown to put the Montoursville Warriors on top of Loyal Sock by a score of 6-0. Later, second quarter, Brian Kennedy. Quick drop back. He'll find Eric Steinbacher. 13-yard pass play. Montoursville on top, 13-0. We move to late second quarter action. Jeremy Brown will take the handoff, and he will go all the way as he gets the ball from Brian Kennedy. Montoursville defeats Loyal Sock 32-6. They advance to the District 4 playoffs starting next weekend. Game number two, Harrisburg at Williamsport. Second half action, Millionaires trailing 13-7. Quarterback Damone Buxton, right flare pattern, and he will find Jermaine Bolden. The ball's at the Cougar 13. Two plays later, the give is to Kevin Brown. Brown sweeps wide left side, and he will tie the game following the extra point at 13 apiece. Later, Kevin Brown puts the Millionaires on top to stay. He fights his way to the end zone. Williamsport wins 25-13, finishes the season at 9-2. Reporting from Williamsport, Scott Masteller, Eyewitness Sports.
Now here's a look at the other scores of games played throughout the area tonight. As always, we sincerely hope that your favorite team won.
Well, as you can see, we have an addition to the scoreboard show tonight. You're probably all of this guy, the missile, Quadry Ismael, in from the University of Syracuse. Quadry, a great season for you so far. It's got to feel good to be mentioned in the same breath with the top Heisman Trophy candidates and Desmond Howard.
Well, I just think that it's a great honor, but I just look at this season as just trying to maintain the consistency that I've had in the past games, and I just think that the Heisman is just pretty much the gravy or the icing on the cake.
And it's been a great season so far in terms of the competition, led by, of course, that loss at Florida State, but you still got had a good game there.
Well, I just, unfortunately, we did lose, and I'm glad I was able to contribute to our team. Unfortunately, I didn't contribute enough, and I think we learned our lesson from that game and from the East Carolina loss, and we've been able to maintain our composure when things got tough and pull out some good victories.
What about your team now? They're mentioning the Orangemen of Syracuse in terms of the Blockbuster Bowl. Your thoughts on possibly playing in that bowl, maybe against Tennessee?
Well, I just think that'll be a great opportunity. Tennessee's a fine team. I'll be watching them. They go against Notre Dame this weekend. So I just think that, well, we'll just hope for the best, but we just got to go out there and play against Boston College.
You proved some of your critics wrong. A year ago, they said you couldn't catch the football. You said, my hand was hurt. It was hurt. This year, you've proved them wrong. How does that feel?
It feels awesome. I'm glad my hand is back to normal, and everything's been working out fine for me. I know I put a lot of hard work in the summer to get where I'm at, so I feel pretty good about it, and I'm glad that everything worked out.
We thank you for coming in. Continued success, and go get them in Florida in the ball game at the Orangemen of Syracuse.
Thank you.
Quadry Ismael, of course, of Syracuse University. One mention on Penn State. Of course, they're back in action tomorrow. They'll play at Memorial Stadium in Baltimore against the Maryland Terrapins. Let's see, the 76ers won. The Flyers lost. We're through. More football tomorrow for Sid and Quadry and the gang. Thank you. Now back to Keith in the studio.
Jim, once again, the sports team scores. Nice
Thank
to see you, Quadry.
Okay.
Coming up next, the details.
For 4 months, Morel Devlin has been hammering the weights and going through intense aerobic workouts several hours a day, up to 6 days a week, preparing for this weekend's contest. But that's the easy part. The tough part is the intense dieting.
Initially, you follow a very good low-fat diet and try to cut back on different kinds of carbohydrates, and then you switch and deplete your carbohydrates and take in more protein, and then switch it again and go back to the carbohydrates to get pumped.
In January, he was consuming up to 5,000 calories a day. So then what we started to do was take that down slowly, week by week, 500 to 1,000 calories.
But dieting and weight training still aren't the only things that's involved in getting set for a bodybuilding contest. Morel will spend as much time on his posing routine as he will on lifting weights and on watching what he eats.
You can go out and you can do a real nice arm pose, but if at the same time you're doing your arm pose, you're not flexing your legs and your abdomen, it doesn't look right.
And then finally, there's that all-important tan, which in Morel's case is instant. His trainer applies the final few coats that he hopes will help his appearance.
The lighting is there, and you know, you put oil in your body so the light reflects properly, and the tan seems to bring out a lot of the cuts in the body that you have.
At the age of 36, most athletes are starting to wind down. For Mo Devlin, winding down means reaching his peak and looking his best. Sid Michaels, Eyewitness Sports.
Meet different kind of kids, you know, and their parents, they love it because they so happy, you know, everything's going fine, so we like doing that.
No, mainly we're doing it for the little kids. The kids get a closer look at us and to see some of our other talents other than football.
The aerobic challenge for the TV28 sports crew placed us in the high-octane, energetic world of a tremendous workout, high-impact aerobics. It is a sport that taxes you from the first minute to the last, a full hour, and anyone looking to get into shape will get all they want, and then some.
Well, I think, Jim, because you have the fun music to listen to, a lot of people gather together, and they just have a lot of fun and different routines you can learn, a lot of challenging things.
One of the more difficult portions of the workout is getting the dance routines down and not feeling like a total incompetent with no coordination whatsoever. But Renee quickly points out that everyone stumbles along in the beginning. But once you get it down, the dividends physically are great.
They're definitely afraid of that, but that's all part of becoming fit. Getting your flexibility and your coordination, that's all part of the process of working out.
We started with the most intense workout of them all offered at the athletic club, high-intensity aerobics. We made our fashion statements early, stumbled to a new level of humility, but had a lot of fun.
You with me? There you go. Up and out.
Monday night, the final part of the workout, power stepping for an hour at the Athletic Club on Route 315 in Plains Township.
Different arms. Go back. One more right here in the center. Three.
The second half of our intense aerobic workout was the latest craze in this sport. It's called the power step. Our instructor for this class was Mary Frances Swales, and she put the eyewitness sports team and the rest of this class through another one-hour session that taxed us all to the max.
Right foot, next.
Your feet aren't leaving the floor. They're either on the floor or on the bench. You're not doing any kind of bouncing, but you have to lift your whole body up on that step, up and down, and it's just a constant motion, and that's what makes it so intense.
As you can plainly see, the dance routine and the step portion of aerobics is again an area that all new students must stumble their way through before you can even begin to understand the conditioning aspect of this high-intensity sport. You feel good about the class, good about the workout, and more importantly, feel good about yourself.
Just three times a week is all you need. If you're going to go out there and you're going to be a diehard and you're just going to try and work out every day, you're going to get sick of it and you're going to get burnt out. But if you just keep a moderate level, like three times a week, that's all you need.
We spent 2 hours enjoying back-to-back aerobic classes. We found out that the workout was more than demanding, the friendship was always there, and the health aspect was the overriding factor. We did it, or I should say survived it. And if we can, you can too. So enjoy yourself and have a healthy workout with aerobics.
And now, from your hometown station, WBRE-TV, this is Eyewitness News. With anchor Keith Martin, Vince Sweeney has the AccuWeather forecast, and Jim Miller on sports. This is Eyewitness News Nightcast.
This is a night of historic celebration at the Lackawanna County Stadium as Red Barons fans join the team in celebrating the first International League Division Championship in the four-year history of the franchise. Good evening. The Red Barons tonight fulfilled the destiny their fans have only dreamed of until now, a pennant and a spot in the postseason playoffs. Jim Miller and Sid Michaels live right now savoring the moment. Guys, you should shave before you go to work.
Keith, it is just madness here in the locker room where the Red Barons have won the International League Eastern Division title. It's been a long 4 years. It was inevitable this was going to happen.
I'll take over for Sid. So many people waited so long. Stay with us. That's the real story here tonight. Where is he, Bill? Come on in here.
All right, Jimmy.
Bill Terlecki, what does this feel like?
Well, an awful way, but it's the most fun I think we've had yet. 4 years, and here we go, Jimmy.
We're going to attempt to do a television program now. Commissioner Corcoran is here. This dream is a reality. How's it feel?
It feels terrible. This is the most dangerous interview I've ever done in my life.
Congratulations, because this dream is now a championship, and we salute you in your efforts.
Thank you very much, Chip. And
I'll finish it off.
The only thing I can say is the team that beat us on opening night in 89, we beat tonight.
We're going to send it back to Keith Martin, and believe it or not, in 20 minutes, we're going to have a sportscast for you. Now back to Keith.
Jim, thanks very much. I'll rescue you there. By the way, I hope they bring that shirt back, bring it out a little bit later on. In case you missed it, the Red Barons made history tonight with a doubleheader win. Jim Miller live in the locker room at the Lackawanna County Stadium. Jim, Lee Elia knows how to dress for the occasion.
He really does know how to dress. He dressed a lot better than I did for the celebration about 15 minutes ago. It's a tremendous feeling for everyone in this community who dreamed that dream years and years ago, and tonight it became a reality. The Red Barons won a doubleheader and clinched the International League's Eastern Division regular season championship. And before we talk to Lee, or while we talk to Lee, Sid Michaels now joins us. Let's look at the locker room celebration once again. These players as a team put it all together. And when you get in this position, not only to win a championship, you come together as people. And these kids came together as people here tonight as they won a championship. And then after that, they left this locker room and went back to say thank you to better than 500,000 fans collectively who also share in this miracle dream. And Mr. Ilya, how does it feel?
Well, it's special. Everyone is special in its own way. You've been a gamer. You know how good these things are. But hey, we have a lot to be thankful for. We're representing a great area, a great stadium, and some super, super fans. And I know if I was speaking for these guys out in this room, we're appreciative of their support, and we're thankful for the outcome of a hell of a year. And we'd like to do it one more time for everybody.
They wonder how you do it with players coming and going. The basic bottom line of baseball is still pitching. If you can pitch, you have a chance to win.
Well, we've had good pitching and good defense all year long. Regardless, at times it looked like maybe we were getting raped, but somehow the Philly organization gave us a compliment that kind of fit into the mold. And quite frankly, we had some constants on this ball club. Uh-huh. Greg Legge, Mauser, Ricky Hsu were the guys that were here all year that kind of set a little bit of a tone in the locker room. But if you look back through the whole year, it was without a doubt a team effort. And we thank the fans for being supportive.
We congratulate you and salute you and your staff on a job well done.
Thank you very much. It was a great experience.
Thank you. Manager Lee Ilya, the Scranton Wilkes-Barre Red Barons, the International League's Eastern Division champions. And joining us now is Kim Batiste, and he's dried off. You were here last year, part of this year. You look around your teammates. What does this mean to a ball player?
It's unexplainable. I mean, you can't explain it. The feeling is all inside. I mean, these guys work hard, they deserve everything they got, and it's just a feeling to where you can just do like they're doing now and celebrate and enjoy.
And enjoy one another, because it still comes down to the players. This is still, number one, the players' game.
Definitely it is, and something like this should do tends to bring a team a lot closer than before, because when you do things together and be successful and then get a reward at the end, everybody comes close and it make you just want to go at the next thing a little bit more harder.
Congratulations and good luck in your major league career in the not-too-distant future.
All right, thanks.
Kim Batiste of the Scranton Wilkes-Barre Red Barons. This is going to be a Red Barons championship show tonight, and the guy who's been here through all of it, the original Red Baron, Mr. Greg Legge. This has got to be super.
It's great. It's a great feeling. We earned it, and we deserve it.
When you look around all these kids, and you're the elder statesman of this club, what is it like for you to see them share this reality?
It's fun. I know how they feel. My first year in pro ball, we did the same thing. We won the division, but we lost in the playoffs.
But
it was
just
so exciting. You know, the morale's good, and you've got to continue for the rest of the year.
Quick story. You carried the ultrasound picture of your future baby in your pocket. Tell us about that. It's dry, and it made it through a great game by yourself.
Today I watched the baby, and the wife went and had an ultrasound done, and she came to the park about 5 minutes till six and gave me the picture and said, she had three of them. She said, here, you keep one and keep it in your pocket for good luck. And it turned out good. We won both games, and we clinched the pennant, and here we are. And I might have to carry it around again tomorrow.
Congratulations. You helped us all sharing a great dream come true tonight.
It's great fun. Thanks.
Greg Legge of the Scranton Wilkes-Barre Red Baron, Sid Michaels, now joins me. We're not going to have time to show you, obviously, the Little League Baseball World Series today. Tell us who won it, Lee.
Well, the Far East, again, a representative from the Far East, not from Chinese Taipei or Taiwan, but from the Philippines. They beat Latin America today 5-1 to a